Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second in our series, CS Plus Dance, sponsored by DoD STEM and the National Center for Women and IT, of which I am a consultant and have been for 7 years. I am TJ Aladdin, and it's a pleasure to be here with you all tonight. Thank you for joining. Today, we're going to be talking about the intersection of computer science and dance, which is personally exciting to me and to my younger self, because maybe about 20 years ago, my parents told me that dance is not a real career and that I needed to focus on something serious. So we compromised and I did a bit of dance and a bit of science. And I hope that they're watching now because they can see that this absolutely is a career. And I have other people on the line to prove that. So before we get started, I would love for you all to introduce yourselves. Please drop your name, state in the chat. And if you have a question for today's speakers, please feel free to put that in the chat as well. I'm gonna advance very quickly to our next slide. So, NCWIT is a nonprofit community founded in 2004 with support from the National Science Foundation. We do a ton of stuff with a ton of people. We have over 1,600 partners in the workforce, colleges, universities, nonprofits, you name it, we do it. And it is all in support of women and non-binary technologists all around the nation. And we are putting on this fantastic event with our partner, DoD STEM, the Department of Defense, who also has a ton of amazing programs for students as well as for teachers, which you can check out in the chat. And without further ado, I'm gonna pass it on to our speakers to introduce themselves. I'm gonna start from the left on my screen. And Yamilee, are you on camera with us?
Yes.
Excellent.
Hi, I'm Yamilee. I'm the founder and CEO of STEM From Dance, and I am based in New York City.
Excellent. Thank you so much for joining us. Next up is Kiyah.
Hi, I'm Kiyah Stokes. I'm a K-12 instructor based out of Memphis, Tennessee for Code.Crew.
Awesome. Thank you. And last but not least is Jean.
Good evening, everyone. Excuse me. I am Jean-François Mahoro. I am the director of K-12. For Code.Crew, and I am as well based out of Memphis, and I'm excited to look forward to the conversation tonight.
Thank you all so much for being here. We're just gonna jump right in. My first question is not really a question, it's a test. I would love for our panelists to give us like a Shark Tank-like pitch of your like work. This could be a project you're working on, your like organization as a whole. Pitch to us like we're on Shark Tank and like we're funders, because actually we have a question for the audience after your pitch that's going to ask them how much they would actually fund your particular project. So with that being said, who would like to go first?
Sure, I'll go.
Okay.
Oh, wait, you were going to go? You could go ahead.
Sure, no problem. Let me go ahead and share my screen if you are giving 1 second. Let's do this.
Please take it. Oh, yeah, your slides ready, you guys. This is serious. This is serious.
I try. So hopefully if everybody can see my screen.
Yes, we can.
Thumbs up. All right, awesome. This is Zoom. So let me move these controls out of the way. All right, fantastic. So again, good evening or good afternoon, depending on which side of the country you're on. Again, it's a pleasure to be with everyone that's here on the call that's part of this webinar. But yes, if you allow me just a few minutes, I'd like to share a little bit about Code.Crew and what we do. And again, hopefully you have some questions at the end, but let's go right through it. Again, we're based out of Memphis, Tennessee, and who we are since 2015, we have pretty much directly impacted over 10,000 unique K-12 students, but also adult students as well, to further impact more than 1 million kids in Tennessee through advocacy for computer science education as well as legislation. And really our why, right? Before I go to our why, let me talk about really our mission statement, right? So Code.Crew works to bring diversity and inclusion to computing through education, exposure, and advocacy. And there will be some core values that we like to share and also highlight, right? So impact in education and mentoring, quality of excellence and excellence, innovation and perseverance, collaboration and community, creativity and curiosity, and obviously diversity, equity, and inclusion. When you talk about the why, we got to start more like on the top, right? So you're talking about nationally, you know, economies are increasingly depending on the strength in science and technology. But fewer, right, U.S. students preparing themselves for careers in these fields, and business and schools are obviously encountering a declining pool of qualified workers and teachers. And especially here in Memphis, we'll talk about the legislation that's happening here, but computer science is coming up soon, and we're realizing that this is a gap that we need to step in and fill. And really, when you talk about locally here in Memphis, Tennessee, is that is beyond the race and gender gaps, right? And that amplifies for here in Memphis, but especially West Tennessee. And that really comes down to a numbers game. So we want to reduce the gap by half, which will radically transform our city and really just our region as well. And I just say nation as well. So then K-12. So here's how we, there's three parts that we talk about here at Code.Crew, but one of them is K-12. So we do in-school partners where we go out through the school year or the school day where we service. And Kiyah Stokes, we're one of our instructors here, amazing instructor, is one of the individuals that goes out to the school and provide computer science courses in education. And then we do it through after-school programs as well. We have exposure events such as Our Code Hackathon, which is our biggest and fun event that we put on for our kids during the summer, summer camps. But also we collaborate with other organizations. Obviously, STEM from Dance being represented here today is another organization that's doing great work. And for us, instead of reinventing the wheel, we partnered with them to really bring the same quality of computer science to our students. And then just by the numbers, this was based on 21-22, but really it's about, right, 72% of our students attend CS program or class for the first time. And out of that 72, 81 write their first line of code. That's very impactful to know that for our students, even though people say we're in 2023, you know, we see that some kids have never done this before. And again, over 183,000 hour dosage. So we just say we're just a small member of this big pool that we're really trying to move the needle around computer science. And then the other leg is professional development. So we provide training and resources for our K-12 instructors, really around computational thinking, algorithmic thinking, and basic programming for teachers, right? And then for us, we also have ongoing programming to support our teachers. And then with CS4R, we have a Script Crew Tennessee, which is what we do is around implementation with districts across the state. So if you want to know how to bring computer science, there's a framework that we walk you through and support you through that process. And sorry, I'm speeding through all this, and let me get to the next part. But then we talked about the adults. And in the adults, we have a hands-on class designed to train adults to be entry-level software engineer. And for us, we make sure that they really do real-world technology to learn the fundamentals of coding, app development, leadership, and life skills needed for successful career in the job market. And obviously, the most important thing is to make sure that they have job placement after graduation. Same thing with Code School by the numbers. These are 21-22 numbers. We have four out of five stars in terms of rating of the course, 100% rating. But the beauty about this is we try to make sure that they come up with at least $50,000 job placement in terms of starting salary. So that's very important, especially if you're talking about living wage and opportunity to support families as well. And last but not least, we don't stop here. So what's next? As you heard me earlier mention, Code.Crew worked alongside other members to pass the legislation to make computer science offering required for all K-12 students in Tennessee starting 24-25. So we're positioning ourselves to not just start the movement, but really be part of the movement along the way as well. And last but not least, I think I saw in the chat that our executive director is on the call, but he says that while we started Memphis, our gift to the nation is showing how we bring diversity to tech. And with that, I just have a quick highlight. We do, speaking of teacher professional development, we do have an opportunity for anybody that's on the call. I will share this information as well, maybe at the end of the call, to be able to know that we have already starting to think about how do we support people in this field. So that's my time. If you have any question, please, this is how the different ways you can contact us. You can follow us on social media. Again, thank you. And I'm going to yield back my time.
Thank you so much. I'm very serious about my investments. And so I have some questions. Okay, just kidding. So for everyone in the audience, you get to decide. I'm going to launch this poll. Hopefully you can see it. For how much would you fund this project? 25K, 50K, 75K, or 100K? And this is all in NCWIT dollars. This is not money. This is not real US dollars. These are NCWIT dollars. I do have a question, actually. Do you think that this program can be scaled nationally outside of Tennessee? And if so, how would you go about doing that?
Right, absolutely. As again, I quote our executive director, that's one of the things that's very, we're passionate about it, right? So we're thinking about other cities that are similar to Memphis. We think about Jackson, Mississippi, New Orleans. Just naming those two cities, they really desperately need the same thing that we have here. So we want to be on, like, find boots on the ground and give them the roadmap, give them the framework to say, okay, here's how Code.Crew started, and we put it in their hands, but also support them the first part as they try to unroll the program out, but really say you have to be in your own city and also bring another Code.Crew version as well. So that's one way I can see scaling up.
Awesome. Thank you for that.
Thank you. And like I said, no pressure. You I'm seeing this money. It's like interesting, but thank you.
Can everyone see the answers to the polls or not yet? Not yet. Okay. You have five more seconds to put in your votes. It won't let me vote. That's not fair. All right, we're gonna close this poll and share the results. So Code.Crew, you have just walked home with over 1.2 million NCWIT dollars to fund your programming. But I want 100% equity, 100% stake in the company.
Thank you.
Just kidding. Okay. All right. Thank you all for participating. We have one more pitch, and that is from Yamilee. Take it away whenever you're ready.
Great. Can I have the ability to share my screen?
Absolutely can. I think Brittany is going to take care of that for you on the back end. You should have it now.
Fantastic. Great. Well, I got to say, I'm a huge fan of Code.Crew, so it's an honor to share this stage with you all, and excited to share about the work STEM from Dance is doing. And actually, one second, I want to reshare with checking these boxes. All right. Great. Let me just hide. All right. Well, super excited to share about STEM from Dance. I'd love to start with this opportunity we've identified. Can we all imagine a world where women of color are equitably represented in the STEM workforce? As you imagine this world, it leads to more innovation, greater economic prosperity. Well, that's the world STEM from Dance seeks to create. Our goal is to empower 1 million girls of color with the know-how, experience, and confidence to dream big in STEM, all through the power of dance. Now, we've been able to accomplish quite a bit so far, being able to serve over 3,000 girls, 10 years of impact. You know, we're seeing results. We're able to serve those who are underrepresented in STEM. And yet there's still so much more to be done. Because check out some of these stats. As young as 5 years old, girls start to develop thoughts of doubting themselves, limiting themselves. It's as young as 8 years old that many girls have already lost confidence in math. As they get older, we see similar patterns. Ages 13 to 17, 9% of girls said they want to pursue a career in STEM, compared to 27% of boys. And we see how this leads to ultimately women of color occupying only 5% of the STEM workforce. Now, the question is, why is this so? And there's a few things. One, girls don't see themselves as scientists, engineers, mathematicians, programmers. They often see somebody who looks like this. They don't see somebody who looks like me. And we know that math anxiety starts to creep in. They start to question their ability. And these careers and opportunities aren't as known or are available to girls of color. And this is something that I have personally experienced studying mechanical engineering at MIT. I know what it feels like to be in a room and not see myself represented and have that doubt, that anxiety start to creep in. And so, you know, it's time to change this. And the time is now. And so I would love to share about the work that STEM from Dance is doing. Here's the mission once again. We're all about empowering these girls through dance to be our next generation of STEM workforce. And I'd love to share how we do that. You know, we target girls who don't see themselves as a STEM person. Girls who are often excluded and have lost that spark for STEM at a young age. And what we're able to do is allow them to create these dance routines. You can still hear me over this background. But they get to make these dance performances that incorporate STEM, science, and technology, like programming drones against alongside them, using circuits and sensors. Machine learning to program the animation that they find in other states. And having girls who may have initially lacked confidence in STEM walk away with a vibrant, like-minded experience to connect with, to lift each other up, to never feel alone in their STEM journey. And they get to gain this confidence to turn their ideas. And so some things I like to highlight in the work is we're making sure that their culture is reflected in STEM, that they're building that confidence, they're gaining a community, and being able to foster that creativity that does exist within them through making these performances. And so a bit about how our program operates. We have three phases. One, Catalyze, which is one-day summits and clubs. Then in Immerse, they get to go deeper during our three-week summer program, and Launch, where we help them get into the STEM fields, all the while building community along the way. And we deliver programs directly in New York City and indirectly through partnerships nationwide. And so would love to start to wrap up with a quick story about Melody, who came to us because of her passion for dance. And over the years that she came to our summer program, started to develop this love for STEM as well, computer science in particular. And now she is a sophomore at Georgia Tech studying computer engineering. And so to me, it's just amazing that that spark of dance can lead to that transformation. So would love to talk about how we are growing. Like I mentioned, we have started in New York City and have been able to partner with organizations across the country, including Code.Crew and Memphis. And want to ultimately share that our vision is to connect 1 million girls of color to STEM education and careers. So that is what we're on the path to doing. Would love to partner with those who would love to join us on this journey. So here's my contact information, the organizations. Would love to have conversations and just see what's possible. So thank you for giving me this time to talk with you all. And I will pause here.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Yamilee. I'm going to launch the second poll to see, once again, for how much would you fund this project? 25K, 50K, 75K, or 100K? And while everyone is submitting their responses, I would just like to share that we will be giving away a $100 Visa gift card for those who fill out the survey to give us feedback about this series. You do need to stay on the webinar till the end to get the link to the survey to be entered to win the Visa gift card. So even though I think these people have just given very impressive and thorough pitches, there's more to discuss, so please don't leave us just yet. Okay, I'm gonna give it about 5 more seconds to wrap up the poll. Get your votes in if you haven't already. All righty. Yamilee and Stem From Dance are going home also upwards of 1.2 million NCWIT dollars. Thank you everyone for participating in that short but fun and informative little intro to our call. I now just wanna take a deeper dive into the topic, CS plus dance. So my question to the panelists is, what does CS plus dance mean to you? While they're thinking of their responses, if you have a question for the panelists about their organization, about their work, about their journey, feel free to pop it into the chat at any time. So I'm gonna get started with Kiyah, because we haven't heard from you yet. What does CS plus dance mean to you?
CS and dance means actually the world to me, because I just never thought that I can combine two things that I absolutely love in the world. Because growing up, I actually didn't know I wanted to do computers until probably like middle school. And when I was younger, I always wanted to do something performance-based, whether it would be acting, singing, dancing. I just loved being like, I love performing. And then my teacher is like, okay, let's think of something else. What else you want to do? So I was like, I don't know what else I want to do. So, you know, you say lawyer or doctor or something. So I said one of those. But in middle school, I started really getting into computers, because I remember my mom having like the big like 2001 computer in our home office, and I'll sit on her lap and she'll let me click all these buttons. And it just stuck to me from there. And just growing up, having that passion to perform and dance and have CS combined with it, I didn't think it was possible until I actually became an adult. I was like, wow, this is amazing. I guess to combine my favorite two things, especially going to CS for All and finding a company like a nonprofit organization like Stem From Dance. It's like, I didn't think this was possible. And then I was like, this is my passion. This is where I'm supposed to be, combining these two things together. So it means the world to me. It means creativity and innovation combined. So that's why I think CS plus dance means to me.
Thank you so much for that response, Kiyah. Yamilee, you can follow that up. Good luck.
I mean, so much of what you just said resonated with me. I have experienced these two things separately, almost like in parallel. And what has been exciting for me is realizing that these two worlds do collide, that they can enhance one another. And I think that has, like, my journey with Stem From Dance has allowed me to, you know, come up with ideas and see them come into fruition and see what happens when we ask the girls to think about ways to combine these two things together. So to me, it means like a way of bringing two things that I also care a lot deeply together, not just for the sake of combining them, but to make a change in the world. And I do believe that the combination will lead to young people who are going to be affecting the world that we live in a really positive way. So yeah, that's what the combination means to me.
Thank you so much. And last but not least, John.
All right, thank you. I'm not going to repeat most of what Kiyah have already said, but I'm going to probably take a different approach to this and say that's the reason why we have somebody as talented as Kiyah here on our team, because I remember we were talking about STEM from dance and Girls Rise Up, bringing a program as such, especially for our young girls, because computer science, I'm a software engineer, and yes, it can get nerdy. So how do you start to allow students who come from different backgrounds, different thoughts, because creativity is there, the arts are there, and technology is immersing everything that we do. And even this summer, this is the first time we had a program that was like 100% retention all the way through. So the impact is there, giving the students the tools and the ability to express themselves and still do computer science. To me, that's why I love everything about this and even having this opportunity to talk about computer science and dance, because they really go hand in hand. You create things in computer science, in music, and dance. You're also creating, you know, your algorithm, if you were talking about like the steps that you do, like all these things that you, even when you're talking about from a computer science, you're already doing in dance. So it's like literally showing how those two things have come together. So that's really why I would just echo everything that she said about, you know, resilience. I would add resilience as well to be able to do dance and computer science as well.
Thank you all so much for those responses. It makes me think about my own, I guess, journey into dance and CS, which came through dance science. So I got, oh my gosh, in 2010, ages ago, I got my master's in dance science. And at the time I went to the only university literally in the world that was offering a mixed dance and science degree. I got to study physics, biomechanics, stats, so many things. And it's not 2010 anymore, it's 2023, but I have to admit, I was still surprised when I saw that there was more than one organization that was gonna be on this call, because I still have found that the work happens in silos, or at least in very small, like, you know, communities, not that many people are doing it. So I was like, oh, there's two different organizations in the US that are doing this work with girls, like, that's amazing. And so that brings me to my next question, which is, do you think dance and CS is seen as novel? And do you think it's seen as non-technical? And if so, why? If not, why not? Feel free to just jump at this one, whoever wants to go first.
I'd say my experience has been that the combination of the two can be either viewed as almost like a gimmick, like let's sneak the medicine in the, what's the analogy, applesauce or something. And what I like to advocate for is the benefits are beyond that. We're not just trying to sneak upon these girls we're serving, but really try to reach them where they are, really show them that they do belong in CS, and using dance as a way to show that. So that's what I'd say. And you know, on the dance side, dance can be seen as something that is purely for entertainment. But I think those who have experienced the power of dance know that it has the potential to really change how we view ourselves, how, what we think we're capable of. It really does have an impact on how we develop our, like how young people can develop. So I also like to advocate for dance not just being seen as something that's simply fun to do, but something that has the power to bring about change.
Thank you. Any other thoughts, Jean or Kiyah?
All right, I guess I'll go. Could you explain the question just a little bit more? I wanna make sure I understand.
I think because, at least this is from my experience, the arts in general have a sort of a vibe, a social lens that it's looked at upon. And it's very different than how people look at, like, you know, computer science. People look at, like, you know, CS and think, they think math, they think intelligent, they think numbers and organization and, you know, lots of sort of, you know, mental capacity. And dance is seen, I think, incorrectly as strictly, like, you know, creative or for, like, in entertainment. And so I guess I'm wondering, with these things combined, do you think that it's challenging perhaps for people to kind of digest what we're actually talking about when mm-hmm. we talk about dance and CS?
All right. Well, it can be, that's the beauty of, like, the arts and still, like, the sciences. Like, they can go either way, either or, because I've been in dance classes where it is super technical. Like, I can, like, I have to know these counts, this count to this beat, this is a half beat, you don't step right here. Dance can be very, very technical. Even though it is a creative outlet, it's still certain rules you have to follow. Ballet, for example, very strict, very technical. Or you freestyle dance, hip hop is more freeing, more freeform, things like that. And then even with computer science, not everything is, like, straight technical. Some of it is just so simple, like block coding, fitting these two things together, or pattern recognition. When people think of computer science, they do think of computers in that capacity, but we also want to think of computational thinking, right? Because we do K through 12. So, like, our younger kids, you know, our K through 3 in that range, you know, we're not having them do text-based coding right away, right? So we have to, like, introduce different concepts, like I was saying earlier, pattern recognition, thinking critically, what would come next? How would you solve this? Like, what would you do in this problem? Like, how would you break this problem down? You know, things like that. So they really go hand in hand. And like I said, dance can be very technical and computer science can be very, like, free or very creative in that capacity. So I guess it just depends on how you look at it. I think it's so interchangeable that I believe it's just not one answer, right? It's just, you know, that's the best way I can explain it. It's so versatile. It's so versatile in so many ways.
I think that was the best way to explain it. Very clear. And I think made that point really well. Jean, do you have any thoughts you want to add or, like, anything you want to echo?
Sure. I mean, that was beautiful. And really the only thing I would add to that is, again, when we come from the world, when we think about computer science and just the technical aspect of computer science, I would be misjudging here to say that somebody that does dance, as again, as Kiyah just mentioned, the technical aspect of learning how to do that takes computational thinking, like she said, critical thinking and problem solving skills, believe it or not. Like, you just don't step on the floor and know automatically what to do. So there's a thought process behind that. And I think we'd be remiss if we said that there's no way to bring those things. I think whoever says that, I don't think they really are open to the idea. And I think that's where we are right now, is, like, being open to the idea of the possibility, because otherwise, keeping it very technical, you realize that you're missing a large pool of, you know, demographically wise in terms of kids and really diversity of thoughts as well. Like, this is how we get into the trouble of having one track minded and everybody think the same, but you gotta have people to think differently. So you gotta challenge the status quo per se.
Don't get me on the diversity train. I said it. I'm getting on it. Let's talk about it. I'm gonna stick with you, Jean. So you kind of alluded to sort of dance as a means of reaching out to certain populations that might otherwise be excluded. Can you talk a bit more about that?
Sorry, was that back to me?
Yes,
back to me. Sure, why not? So I think, yeah, culturally, the way we perceive things, the way we're raised, again, I'm gonna use for example, she said even her backstory, like how you're raised, you don't want to be discounting the idea that you can do certain things because of your upbringing. Dance is a form of art, it's a form of expression. Everything that we build, we talk about infrastructure, technology, is a form of expression of somebody who built stuff, right? That's why I keep saying, I think this is how you show kids where, for them, again, culturally, it may not be something that they see or hear in their home, but we all listen to music. We dance around. I have a 3-year-old. So it's like, these are the things that we're comfortable with and we know well. So how do we use something we're familiar with to introduce complex topics such as computer science?
Thank you so much for that. I want to put a call out to the audience. I would love if people could share in the chat any experiences they have with dance. Are you all dancers? Do you just like watching? What types of dance? Contemporary, ballet, modern, gram, technique? I'm just curious to know where people are coming from and what your backgrounds are. And then while we're waiting for that, I want to ask our panelists, what is the most difficult part of your work?
I guess I'll go first. So my job specifically, I would say, I guess I have two sides, right? I have like my teacher side, and then I have like my technical computer science side, as far as like I wouldn't say the industry, because I don't really have industry experience, but I guess like the project-based side. I think the hardest part is like trying to make it fun for the children that really like aren't connecting with it, if that makes sense. Because sometimes we go into a school and it's like you have a few students that just, you know, they don't, I won't say they don't appreciate it, but they like don't see what we see when we see computer science. So it's like, because it can get hard, it can get frustrating, right? And I just want to show them, like, as far as them not wanting to pursue computer science, it's like, that's fine, it's not for everyone. But I do want them to see that these are important problem solving skills. So it's it gets a little hard, because like some hard concepts, like when we do conditionals or functions, you know, I try to make the projects as simple and as fun as possible. And sometimes, you know, it gets a little difficult for them. And I think that's just the hardest part, trying to just get those kids to see that it's not that hard and it's not that scary. Especially like you said, your upbringing, especially you have no idea, like this is like your first coding class, it seems overwhelming, things like that. So that's the hardest part. It's just introducing those concepts to kids that have it in the back of their mind that I don't need this, or I don't think this is important. So it's just getting them to realize that it may be a little bit important in the future, you know, just to appreciate what you're learning a little bit more. I think that will be the toughest side.
Thank you so much for sharing that. Jean, you want to go next?
Sure. For me, as I lead our K-12 team as a director, I think for me is working with, whether it's partners, schools, even though some of us have heard computer science for a while, it's still a new topic, a new concept. Similar to students, how do I share this information that's very important from a structure standpoint? Because we also don't want to just bring computer science or coding, as we, you know, I use air quotes, coding, and then we just want to do it, right? But there's a process to it. You got to do the computational thing, you got to do critical thinking, you got to do problem solving. Again, it's not just computer science. You can see your math scores increase, your reading level, your English in terms of how you write papers, for example, how you do your reporting, science, how you view and visualize those things. Again, paying attention to details. So really trying to say how this cross-curricular is important, to where they just don't think, well, I'm not ready for computer science, or only a few of my students want to do computer science. So it's really, for me, it's try to understand where they are, meet them where they are, and offer them a way to make it happen, not count them out. Because I know sometimes, again, it's the fear of the unknown, and I'm trying to let them know how it works and in the best way I can, in the most simplistic way as well.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And last but not least, Yamilee, I feel like you probably have a lot to say on this, because I feel like you do quite a lot. You're leading an organization. It seems like you kind of built this from the ground up. So this is not just the programs that you're working on, but just still continuing to build this, you know, platform, it seems like, on top of the actual work that you're doing with girls. So can you talk a bit about what have been some of the most challenging things along your way?
Sure. I'm not sure if my video keeps cutting out, but I'm here. So many things I could speak to, but I'd say, you know, in light of the conversation we've been having, you know, part of my responsibility is helping people understand the value of dance in STEM so that, one, there's more of this work taking place, and two, like, the organization can get the resources, the partners, the participants that would really be excited about the mission. And, you know, when I think back to when I first began this idea of, there were no CS plus dance webinars taking place, right? It was a very non-traditional approach, and it was difficult to get funding and get schools to bring us in, because it was just so different than what they were used to. And so that was definitely an uphill battle. But over the years, I've been able to sort of understand what resonates with people, what aspects of dance people understand, what parts that they need an explanation for, same thing on the STEM side of things. So that's definitely been challenging, but now that we have video content and testimonials, you know, now the work can speak for itself. It's just something I continue to think about, because I want to see more of this work take place in the world. So I'm just really passionate about trying to take that challenge and making it an opportunity, and really sort of demystifying what is possible with this combination. So that's one challenge I would name.
I want to go back to something you said about funding. You said it was difficult to get funding, even though NCWA gave you $1.2 million NCWA dollars.
I know.
I guess I'm curious to know what were the struggles? Like, what was it difficult to communicate, and how did you overcome that eventually?
I think in the early years, in general, getting funding for a new idea is challenging, because many people are risk averse. They want to support things that have been proven, when there's, evidence, there's pictures, there's numbers. And I didn't have those things at the beginning, because I was really trying to figure out for myself what it looked like to combine dance and STEM together. And so I had to figure out how to get people to sort of believe in the potential, believe in what was possible, what was not yet to happen, but what was possible. And there it goes again. I also just like for myself as a leader, as a person, just to stay motivated after hearing a lot of rejection and the feedback that wasn't necessarily affirming and encouraging, and to still believe in this idea. So that was the challenge. But there were a few who did believe and who saw the potential and made that early bet. And those early supporters were able to sort of sustain things. And once we had that initial funding, then we could get the the videos and the testimonials and all of that, and really took years to build to where we are now. And even to this day, I still, come across people who are confused about the work that we do. So the fight continues. We're here to because we believe in it. So it's easy to fight for something that we know is effective.
Thank you so much. We have a lot of feedback and questions in the chat, but before we get to that, I'm just gonna take a quick break and deliver a word from our sponsors. Our sponsors is me. The Aspirations in Computing community, which I have had the pleasure of managing for the past 5 years, we are to date 25,000 women and non-binary technologists nationwide. I get to work with our Workforce Alliance partners, our college partners, and these amazing partners to bring opportunities to my amazing community. If you are not already a member, please sign up. There are a ton of benefits. We give you money to have your own meetups locally. We give out awards. We have outreach opportunities, networking scholarships. We actually just were at Afrotech a couple of weeks ago and had some great partner events there. So check out for things like that at different conferences nationwide. And for anyone who is doing some kind of research and also in college, we have our Collegiate Award, which is now open, and the application for the first round closes on November 20th. This is for anyone who is working on a project, whether it's ongoing or completed, that has some sort of technical component. We actually have had some projects submitted in the past that were focused on CS and dance, CS and sport, so on and so forth. So if you have any questions about if your project is a good fit, feel free to reach out. And please do not hesitate to apply. The awards are given out at different levels, so you won't be compared to someone who's a senior in college if you're a freshman. And that's for later. We are now going to get back to our lovely audience. So earlier, I asked folks what their dance connections are. So we have Grace, who does ballet. We have instructor Forte, who at some point took a dance class with a former Beyonce dancer. I love the Beyonce connect. We also have someone who's into aerial silks, Aishwarya. Love aerial silks. When I stopped dancing, I got into aerial silks after, also really amazing. And then we have a question from Mirelle. The question is, as someone studying computer engineering, nope, that's not the question. Here's the actual question from Chinasa. I love dance so much and I wish I could dance, but I can't. I'm sure you got a little something. I'm majoring in CS and I'm interested in careers with these paths crossing. Are there any steps I can take to to work in this field or try it out? So Chinasa is interested in dance, feels like maybe they can't really dance. We can't judge, we can't see you, but I'm sure you've got a little something. Do our panelists have any advice on career paths that they can take to get started in this field?
I would say the beauty of this work is that, you know, you can chart whatever path you're interested in. I know for me, when I was in undergrad, I had no clue that I could be doing what I'm doing now. What I did was just pursue the things that piqued my interest. You know, I started to become interested in education, so that's what led me to become a teacher. I started to think about this role that dance could play. So then I just did a little pilot or project at the school that I was teaching at, the combined dance and STEM. And as I follow that, that's what led to what I'm doing now being my career. So I would say that keep leaning into those interests because you never know what can come from them.
Yeah, and I would like to add exactly what was just mentioned. Just connecting with someone like Stanford Dance, in your career path, to the individual asked that question, yeah, sometimes you might have to go in a space where they're already doing something like this. Build whatever you envision. And showcase and prove a concept, right? And maybe you come up with something that's very unique, and all of a sudden now you own that path, and now people are coming and asking you, well, how did you make this happen, right? So sometimes that's what it may take for you to also carve out a path that may not necessarily be there already. I'm sure that's how STEM from Dance came about. It was nobody was doing CS and dance, and we are talking about it, right? So maybe I would say start connecting with STEM from Dance and see see what it can at least mentor you or just give you some thoughts. But staying in a community like this is already talking about it would help you as well.
Also, I would like to say definitely like what Yamilee and Jean has said, like connecting with different communities, finding different people that share your passions, and maybe even coming up with a project of your own. Like they were mentioning earlier, like it just came into my head. So you said you're not the biggest dancer. So maybe you could come up, but you're a computer engineering major. Maybe you can come up with an app that teaches you how to dance, right? Or some things like that, because I'm a fan of Just Dance, obviously, and Dance Central. And what made me think of it is Dance Central actually has like a little part where it teaches you the dance and the game. So maybe you can do things like that. Like I even had an idea of like, there's different poses. Machine learning can like actually sense different poses now. So maybe you can create an app that will sense a pose, like did you do the pose right or things like that. So I think definitely going into those communities and then like just spark your creativity. I would definitely say that, just like spark your creativity, come up with projects, and definitely reach out to different organizations, or you want to reach out to us, that's fine. You know, maybe we can collab, because you know I love creating things. So like I said, it's just the beauty of creativity and just finding this small community. Like honestly, it's not so small now that I know like all these different people from all different walks of life are here. So you have support. So feel free to like just reach out and just go for it. Because I actually volunteered with Black Girls Code, and I did that all by myself when I was like a junior in college. Like I went to them, I did everything, I did the interview. I was like, this is my first big thing I did by myself. So reaching out can be very scary, especially for me. but it's there, and they're so welcoming. Like you may not, it might be intimidating, but like these communities are so welcoming. So that's what I would say.
Thank you so much, Kiyah. We have a similar question from Morel. I'll just add a little slant to it, which is, do you know of any internships around topics like this, CS, dance, engineering, any internship opportunities you can think of?
I can't say I know of a ton. But I do, you know, Step From Dance has job openings, you know, here and there, and they're posted on our website. So you're definitely welcome to go to the website. I could put it in the chat and see what we have open. Because there may be a role that you see that you're a good fit for. We have, especially over the summer, we have instructional positions now all over the country, especially in New York City. So if that's of interest to teach this work, there's definitely a lot of opportunities. So I'll put the website in the chat.
Thank you. And maybe this is the start of an internship program. Who knows?
Hey, that's funded by NCWIT, and those, and we're going to convert those fake dollars into real dollars. Okay.
Absolutely. I heard that. Okay, a question from Annalise. They love to dance. They have been dancing since they were two. They're into a lot of different styles and are very well-rounded. And I'm the president of the student dance organization. Okay. A senior at Kane University, I think that's pronounced Kane University, majoring in CS and minoring in dance. Question, is there any company that you would recommend that I can apply to that has both my passions of CS and dance integrated?
I'm not sure if they still have this around, but Google actually made like this campaign where they actually took dancers and they made like this AI kind of like experience where they, the dancers do all different types of moves and the AI would predict what dance move they're doing next. So Google, I mean, that's very basic, but that's just something I can come off with at the top of my head. So you might want to go into Google, because Google has done a couple of things with the arts and computer science, which I didn't even know about until like a couple of years ago. So you might want to do a little deeper research into that. But that's the only one I got.
I have a couple of suggestions. So you can check out actual dance companies. they might not actually have postings that are directly related to CS, but that's where you can come in and sort of bring your skills and your ideas and share it with them. I'm sure most of them would be very open. I used to work at the Boston Ballet for a couple of years, and I think from that experience, I can see that many dance companies are trying to come into a more modern era when it comes to technology, and so they'd be open to working with someone with your background. Also, there is a project, it's ongoing, I believe, it's called Embodied Physics. It's based at an organization called TERC, T-E-R-C. I will find the link and put it in the chat once I'm done talking. But they are looking into using dance as a way to teach physics concepts. And so there are lots of research projects like that going around. That's just one place that I know of that's doing that kind of work. So I can share that with you. And I think we have a couple of different options in the chat shared from others as well that can sort of get your research started. And if you find anything that we haven't mentioned, please do let us know as well. And also, sorry, final thought is to search globally. There are people doing this work outside of the US. And so that might be a great place to start your search as well. Okay, this was more exciting than I was expecting. And I had high expectations. So I'm gonna end this off with a final word of advice or guidance from our panelists. So let me make that more concrete. Based on your experiences that you've had so far, what advice would you give to your younger self? And let's start with Jean, and then Kiyah, and then Yamilee.
Ooh, that's a heavy loaded question, right? It's always interesting. Even I get asked this question probably multiple times, but for me, it's always being persistent and being a go-getter. I think we, as a young kids growing up, sometimes we're timid. At least that's my spirit. And people always say I'm calm, I'm collected. I think that's part of my coping mechanism. Is I was always hesitant to do things. But now that I'm understanding that life, that as an adult in the career and as you get to interact with people, is be forthcoming, engage in the moment, be present. And even if you misstep and make a small mistake, it's okay. Like life moves on. But if you don't make the initial step, the first move, then you're always going to say, what if, what was, what could have happened, or something didn't happen because you didn't make that initial move. So for me, it's being a go-getter and go after it and allow your work and your output and your results speak for themselves. Because when you're good at something and you show value, people will listen, people will come to you for ideas. And that's really what I would tell them. There's other things, but I think for me, that's what I would tell my young self.
All right. Basically, I'm just going to piggyback off what John said. For me, I was always so, I wouldn't say I was shy because I still love performing. Like, I wasn't shy, but like asking for things, I was always shy to ask for things. And my mom always told me a closed mouth never gets fed. So I would tell my younger self, do more research, be more outgoing, like ask more questions, like just keep, don't be afraid to ask. Because, you know, back to those old sayings, the worst they can say is no, right? So just keep going. Just keep being persistent, like John said, keep being persistent. Funny story. I tell this story all the time because, like, I had a high school teacher who told me this path was not for me in so many words. So that really just motivated me even more to keep going. So I'll be really proud of myself and tell myself to keep going, you know, so be persistent.
Hey, and I would just emphasize what I said earlier. I think it's just really important to pursue the things that are of interest. without even knowing what the outcome could be. So yeah, I just encourage you all to just pursue those interests and see where they take you.
Thank you all so much. This was so amazing and informative. I just have one more note for us before we hop off. Give me one second. Like dancers, we are open to feedback. And so please help us improve this series by taking the short survey, which the link will be pasted in the chat, and we'll also send it out to you in the follow-up. We hope that you enjoy your time with us. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out. You can connect with us on LinkedIn. Thank you again, everyone, and have an excellent evening. Take care.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.